We thank God for another blessed Sunday. And I'm grateful to not only be here, but to also receive from God. Amen. We thank the entire leadership, all protocols observed. Thank you. All right, we're going to continue with our series on light, equipped with the true. I want to get your feedback. Equipped with the true. And Stephanie, your 30 seconds was not enough, so I'm going to take it from here, right? So Jacob, let me take it from there. Jacob woke up. The word of God said that Jacob woke up, and he said that God was in this place, and I did not know. And the Bible continued to say that, and he was afraid suddenly. And I asked myself, the real question is, why was he not afraid when he got there? Why were you not afraid when you got here? Knowing that God is in what? Is in this place. So don't be like Jacob. Tell your neighbor, my advice to you, don't be like Jacob. Rebuke the spirit of familiarity. In the name of Jesus, amen. A quick recap. The last time we mentioned that light can take on different cover pages or different forms of dimensions. Sometimes it could come in the form of energy. And I pray that the Lord will energize our spirits this morning in the name of Jesus. It could come as power. May the Lord empower you this morning. It could come as revelation. There will be a light bulb moment in your mindset in the name of Jesus Christ. Sometimes it could come as understanding. Other times it could just come as light, because light is the language of the Spirit. When God speaks to you, light, rays of light, throws, it shines from him to you, and you receive a sudden strength in the name of Jesus. And other times it could come as wisdom. Wisdom, say with me, wisdom. It could also come in the form of excellence. I want you to tell your neighbor, it's okay, you can have excellence and the supernatural at the same time. They are not enemies. In the name of Jesus, amen. But today my emphasis would be on wisdom. Wisdom, wisdom. Another time, we will delve into living in the days of Jesus Christ. The subtitle, so main title, equipped with the true light, subtitle will be light for the wise. Let's say it together. Light for the. I believe here we only have wise people. You know the parable of the 10 virgins. 5 foolish, 5 wise. But only here we have only wise people here. Amen. My mom did not give birth to any fool. Sorry about that. We have only wise people in this place. That was just by the way. I'm going to run a bit today. Amen. In our previous study, we also learned that in this kingdom, we move forward by light. It doesn't take long. It takes light. And I want you to understand, and this was Paul speaking to his protege, Timothy. It says that although I am in chains, although I am in prison, I need you to understand something, Timothy. That this gospel, which is light, it cannot be changed. I want you to stand up with me and say, the word of God and his promises concerning my life, it cannot be changed. It cannot be stopped. It cannot be delayed. In the name of Jesus Christ. One of the books and the meaning of the book that excites me the most in the Bible is Exodus. It means exit. It means as Christians, we are never trapped. In the name of Jesus. And if there is anybody trapped, anything of yours that is trapped in the spirit, we release light to set you free. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Light for the wise. See, my light has come. And God said, let there be light. Ladies and gentlemen, God, even God could not create until there was what? Light, until he spoke light first, then he began to what? Create. So it means that light reveals, light empowers, light equips. I ask somebody, are you more spiritual than God? As spiritual as he is, even though he is the father of all spirit, he created something that is tangible, that we can touch and hold. Let's see some product coming from you. Amen. He didn't just speak. He went further to what? To create. Sometimes I feel like the name it and claim it gospel is messing with some people's mind. Master, if you don't work smart and you don't work with the light of God, 1,000 years you'll still be in church. I receive it. Amen, amen, amen. Nothing is going to happen. Go out there and create. Go out there and work. And God will work with you. So the summation of the story is that when it comes to the story of your life, take the pen and write it. Because we are co-laborers with God. We are co-creators with God. What you see in the spirit, you produce it what? In the flesh. Amen. Amen. So take the pen of the story of your life and write it yourself. Because God has sworn by himself that he would never leave you nor forsake you. I came here to also remind somebody and to inform somebody that he has also said in his word that if God be for us, who can be against us? So whatever he has placed in your heart, just do it. Just do it. Just do it. Can you take in some more? Because I'm done. Can you take in some more? You sure? You have capacity. You can take in some more. All right. Let's get it. Amen. All right, all right, all right, all right. Today, I want to start from this background. During the All Leaders Conference, or All Ministers Conference they had recently, they invited the CEO of CDFM, and of course, to sort of speak from the media side of things. And he said that one thing that the church is not so good at is developing and shaping mindsets. I'm not talking about living a holy life. That one, the church has been preaching it ever since. But I said developing and shaping mindset. I'm not talking about being spiritual and praying in tongues. We get those ones. But they said that area, the church is what? It's lacking. And when I think about it, I feel like it's in our attempt to not be carnal and depend on the mind. You know, like we say, the flesh always. We have also gotten to a point where we are pushing God, like everything, we just put it on God. Like God should take 100% responsibility without using what? Our mind. It doesn't work like that. It's always God working with us, through us, and we working with him at the what? At the same time. Amen. So the thinking faculty is a muscle that we need to develop. Just as you go to the gym to work out, you need to develop this mind that God has given us. It's a creative, powerful force. And the most powerful thing on this planet is in here, in between your 2 ears. It's your what? Your mind. I want to go with the template we used the last time. The Bible said that Gentiles or the nations shall come to your light. So today we want to examine another person whose light came in the Bible, and that is King Solomon, a.k.a. Pa Solo. Do we all know Pa Solo? Do we know him? The Bible said that the Queen of Sheba heard of his fame and came to his light. Two things as a bonus, and then we'll just continue. Two things we can learn from him. When his light came, he built God's temple. And I say it this way, this is the chief translation, that if you help build God's church, God will build yours for you. And Akwasi says it this way, that he will block just about 30 minutes or 1 hour to search for a new place of worship. You can also do that. You see, the Bible studies, don't you think whoever is leading, she prepares the PowerPoint, she's blocked some time out of her busy schedule. We are all busy people. But find a 30-minute block somewhere, 30 minutes. I can use this to intercede for the church. I can use this to help somewhere in the media. I can use this to do something. Today, help build God's church as Solomon builds the temple of God. Amen. And two, during his time, there was peace even among his enemies. He signed a lot of peace treaties. I'm not here to talk about the downside of that, but I want you to be intentional and be that peacemaker who brings peace wherever there is confusion. I want you to be very intentional about that. The moment you send confusion, war, storms coming in the workplace, in your classroom, be that peacemaker in the name of Jesus. And that's the wisdom of God at work in the name of Jesus. Give me 1 Kings chapter 10, the NIV version. As he is bringing that on the board, just a little background. And I want you, let's read this as students of the Bible. Don't assume you know. Amen. So Sheba, Queen of Sheba means a place, a location, a town, right? Sheba is present-day Yemen in Southwest Arabia, which was an important commercial center in this period, controlling most of the trade routes in Arabia. Queen of Sheba questioned the wisdom of Solomon, and she traveled to see whether he could live up to the expectation, for he had become a global brand. Somebody here, you are going to become a global brand, a force to reckon with. Amen. Can I get somebody to read with me? NIV. Anybody, any volunteer? But track with me.
1 Kings chapter 10. When the Queen of Sheba heard about the fame of Solomon and his relationship to the Lord.
Pause there. Heard about the fame and his relationship. There was a connection between what? The fame and the two. I pray that your success and fame will be rooted in Christ. That we would always trace it back to what? To Christ. Please continue.
She came to test Solomon with hard questions.
Pause there. With what? With? Thank you. Go on.
Arriving at Jerusalem with a very great caravan, with camels carrying spices, large quantities of gold, and precious stones, she came to Solomon and talked with him about all that she had on her mind. Solomon answered all her questions. Nothing was too hard for the king to...
Pause there. Nothing was too hard for... To explain it to...
Her.
All right. For...
When the Queen of Sheba saw all the wisdom of Solomon and the place he had built...
Pause here too. When the Queen of Sheba saw... Please, pay attention. She didn't hear. When the Queen of Sheba saw... I will take it again. When the Queen of Sheba saw the wisdom, continue, and the palace he had built.
The food on his table, the seating of his officials, the attending servants in their robes, his cupbearers, and the burnt offerings he had made at the temple of the Lord, she was overwhelmed.
Pause there. I love the New King James Version. It says that, and there was no more spirit in her. The American Standard Version says that she was breathless. Means her breath was taken away. She was simply speechless. Continue.
She said to the king, "The report I heard in my own country about your achievements and your wisdom is true. But I did not believe these things until I came and saw with my own eyes. Indeed, not even half was told me. In wisdom and wealth, you have far exceeded the report I heard."
Pause here for me. PIWC, you would agree with me that life is a series of breathtaking moments. There are moments of encounters, moments of experiences. But there comes a time where something happens and your breath is taken away. The English people call it life-defining moments. I believe that was what happened to this queen. Who am I speaking to this Sunday morning? I speak into our collective destiny that the time is coming and the time now is when our wisdom would not only blind our enemies, but it would also cause the nations to be in awe of Adonai. Amen. Pause there for a second. Deuteronomy 28:10 actually says it the way I want it. It says that then all the people of the earth shall see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you. Not just afraid of, they will be afraid of the God in you. They shall what? See. Go back to where you were. Was it verse 6 or 7? Right. Go back to that point for me.
Verse 7. But I did not believe these things until I came and saw with my own eyes. Indeed, not even half was told to me. In wisdom and wealth, you have far
Pause
exceeded.
There. You see, in wisdom and wealth, they go together. In wisdom and wealth. Wealth is not just limited to money. A good name, for instance, could be a social capital. It's a form of wealth. And a good name can buy you things or open some doors that money cannot buy or open for you. Do we agree?
Yes.
Are we on the same page? Ecclesiastes 9, the 16 speaks of something that makes me always sad. I'm going to just sum it up. It speaks of a poor man, a poor wise man who saved the city with his wisdom. But after the Bible says that nobody listened to him because a poor man's wisdom is despised. Wisdom and wealth, they go to what? What am I saying? That if you are wise enough, you will put the word of God to test. And as you do that, you will prosper therein. There is not a single man who has put the word of God to test and it has failed. Because the word of God cannot fail.
Amen.
The wisdom of the poor is despised. Ideally, you shouldn't have the mind of Christ and be poor. Either spiritually or physically. It's an anomaly. But then again, it's a choice. It said what? It said, beloved, I wish above all things that you may, it's a choice, prosper and be in health, even as your soul prosper. Somebody can have it all. Somebody, oh, as for Christianity, it's just persecution. You too, you will enjoy persecution. It's a what? It's a choice. Poor man's wisdom is despised. Go on to verse 8.
Verse 8. How happy your people must be. How happy your officials who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom.
Pause there. She saw the wisdom of Solomon. Your officials, let them continue to hear your wisdom. As for me, I came to see. Let them continue to watch. To hear. Skip the 9 and go to 10.
Verse 10. And she gave the king 120 talents of gold, large quantities of spices, and precious stones. Never again were so many spices brought in as those the queen of Sheba gave to King Solomon.
Amen. Hold on there with me. How much did Bill Gates buy Leonardo da Vinci's Codex Leicester book in 1994? He bought it for $30.8 million. Just a manuscript. Today, it is worth $120 million when they evaluated it last year, that is 2021. So it is not anything new. That means there are actually books that are way more expensive than what? $120 million. People. I just want to draw your attention to something. She gave Solomon 100 and what? 20 talents, which is worth 118 million plus today. That was just the gold without the precious stones. Just 120 talents of gold alone is worth $118 million. There is a saying that poor people know the price of everything and the value of nothing. Wealthy people, on the other hand, they understand the value of everything and know the price of nothing. I want that to simmer in your mind a bit. A poor person, this will never make sense. Why would Begate buy this for 30.8 million? Way back in 1994, add inflation to it, how much would that be today? So when people know your perceived worth, they wouldn't mind paying $1 billion for that idea. Yeah, they will come. So you ask, chief, why did the queen gave so much gift and precious stones or money to King Solomon? I am glad you asked. I can pause here. I am glad you asked. I am glad because he answered hard what?
Questions.
He answered what? Hard. Questions. Remember I said developing this mind? It's not always about shouting kaba 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 in church. He answered hard what?
Questions.
I am glad you asked. Life will reward you when you solve problems. You want to say, I want to make money. God bless. Solve problems. Don't just solve any problem. Solve difficult problems. And at that level, listen, everybody wants to be associated with significance. If you do something right now that's a major breakthrough, you wouldn't know how anybody, all the sportsmen, all the celeb, all the fame, every, you don't know how they will come. They will suddenly come to you. Solve hard what? So let's break it down here. Whether you are creating something tangible or intangible, life will reward you for that. Solomon here had set up something in business we call a money tree. We say money don't grow on trees, but money does grow on trees. If you can set up a money tree, it will continue to give birth to what? Money for you. Amen. This was in the area of content creation today. How many of you have read The Millionaire Fast Lane? Let's read all. All right, MJ DeMarco's book. Get that if you can. The food, the money you used to buy Chick-fil-A, $15, $20, you can buy that book. If it was today, right, it would be like YouTube. People from all over the world would be, you know, could stream to hear Solomon speak. But in the absence of that, they what? They traveled. How many people will have a YouTube channel? I know a few people. Just raise your hand real quick. A few people. All right, cool. Cool. So you are the light. If there is too much darkness on the internet, don't complain. Darkness can only be loud when light chooses to be silent. Say, chief says, darkness would only be loud when light chooses to be what? Silent. If they are dominating, you too dominate. Amen. For Christ. And yours is a better option and a better offer for the world. Amen. So when you think about it, don't be religious about it. I'm the light, I'm the light of this, I'm the light of this. Don't be religious. Think about it well. Because there is a huge responsibility. When you suddenly realize, wow, I am, not somebody else, I am the light of this world. Let's learn a few lessons here, and our time is running. A few lessons, the seeds, wisdom seeds that we can learn from Solomon, Parsolo. One, we see order. Order is the arrangement of people or things in relation to each other to a particular sequence or pattern. 1 Corinthians 14:33 says that God is not the author of confusion or disorder. PIWC, if we want to see the glory of God, let's learn the protocols of the Spirit. Let's learn spiritual patterns, because his glory will not come if that order is not in place. Solomon got something right. That is why when they finally dedicated the temple, the Bible said the smoke of his glory filled the temple so much so that the priests could not stand on their feet. He did something right. He laid everything according to the heavenly what? Pardon. If you are called to lead opening prayer, do opening prayer. Don't do opening prayer and preach. Let there be order in the house. If you are called to do one thing, stick to it. Let there be what? Order in the house. He's a God of what? Order. We see excellence here. Every details, check, check, check. Going the extra mile, the little details, the quality of being extremely good. Don't say it doesn't matter. It matters. Excellence is not cheap, but it's worth every bit of it. Elder John asks me, sometimes a common flyer, we will be going back and forth. We say, no, this doesn't represent us well. Common flyer. We want to make sure when people see it, it speaks with, oh, this is coming from PI. Yeah. It's not a shock. When you do some cocoa, say things, bring, no. Work with Stephanie and the question, simple media stuff, change this to italics, fix this here. So 1 hour over a simple thing. Excellence. Say, be excellent. Go above and beyond. We did not receive the Holy Spirit to be average. You are too anointed to be average. Let me say that again. You are too anointed to be average. We see leadership. At least I see three realms of leadership here. I see thought leadership. I see competence. He was able to answer if there was nothing too hard. And not just that, we see exemplary leadership, even in the place of worship. She witnessed, it says that the burnt offerings that Solomon, not the servant, exemplary, he himself, he led with the burnt offerings. And I feel like that was the last straw that broke the camel's back. And after that, the Bible said that she was breathless. You mean to tell me you can have $1 billion and still come to church and serve as an usher? Yes. You mean to tell me you can be a CEO of a multi-million-dollar company and still come to church and we see you doing the things you're doing, using whatever, vacuum cleaners and doing all of that, that you would think lowly people should do? Yes. Exemplary what? Leadership. We see mental proficiency here. Mental what? Proficiency in this chapter. See, I receive grace for leadership. I receive intelligence from heaven. We see knowledge and experience come alive. We see strategic partnership. We see two kingdoms coming together. We see trade agreement and trade secret after the exchange gift. 8, we see him as a builder. Is it the palace he had what? Built, or the house he had built. Ever since you were born, ask yourself, what have you built? What have you created? How long shall we continue to be consumers, Africans, and not be producers? What have we built? Until we shift this mindset from a consumer mindset to a producer mindset, we ain't going anywhere. And the wisdom of the poor is despised. If we were wise, you would not be here. It's that simple. The secular people tell you, if you were wise enough to do what you are preaching, you will not be there. May I submit to you humbly The United States of America was not built by an army of angels. It was built by men. And the sad thing is that it was even the black men later who came, who did the worst job to build all the skyscrapers you see around. Amen. When you sum all of this up, the order, the excellence, the leadership, the mental proficiency, all of that, when you sum all that up, I call that wisdom. Wisdom is the application of knowledge and in some cases, experience. But the ninth one, the last one is my, I find it the most valuable lessons here. You know, whilst we were reading, I think it was verse 4, right? Put that up real quick. It says that Sheba saw the wisdom of Solomon. And then when you get to 8, it says that your officials, happy are they who continue to hear. She saw, you people continue to hear. The Bible did not make a mistake. It could have used the same words in two places. Here, saw. But it distinguished between hers and theirs. Pastor Chris, I was listening to a tip some years ago. He said that a man of God came to him. Well, maybe not a man, just a man. And he was playing one of the tapes from Kenneth Hagin of Blessed Memory. It was one of his conferences. And the man at some point said, oh, this conference, I was there. Thinking it would make him feel good because he was there live. And Pastor Chris looked at him and said, Father, what happened to you? This was about 15 years ago. He said, Brother, what happened? I was not there. I've only been listening. I've been so blessed. I've been playing this over like a million times. You were there, and there is no evidence. Here, so, they are not the same thing. Here, so, they are not the same thing. Here, so, they are not the same thing. Queen of Sheba did not say, I didn't come to play. She did not go to that palace, traveled all those distances to go in. Just here. You see, she went there. She came with a hunger, not just a curiosity, to learn with the intent of what? Seeing. Because real hunger will change your countenance. Real hunger will make you drive through the traffic to go and get food. When you are hungry, you are hungry. A hungry man is what? Hungry man. Last time, even lying on my son, he was so hungry, he was holding something. He started hitting me. He said, are you crazy? I am hungry. It's getting to the breaking point. I'm hungry. And people are desperately seeking solutions all over the world. They are hungry for all sort of what things. And sometimes you cannot blame them because they are hungry. Come on, they were wrong. Could it be that she went there to participate? Because she went there with questions. She had questions before she got there. Not just questions, hard questions. And could it be that those officials who were there were just spectators? They were just what? Spectators. They have access to the anointing, but don't know the use of what? The anointing, so it doesn't profit them. Having proximity to the anointing doesn't mean you are taking advantage or maximizing it. I'll give you an example. One day, it was a Sunday morning, I had a vision. I saw a pastor praying for me, our own pastor. So he came to preach that day, and when he was going, like, Pastor, don't leave today. By fire, by force, something must drop. Just bless me. You know, I just bowed and just said, bless me. And the exact words I heard in the vision was the exact words Pastor spoke. I'm not kidding. After I was amazed. There were three words I heard clearly, distinctly. He said the same thing. What am I saying? You see, there comes a time as human, he comes here often, you become familiar. And so you stop seeing, you begin to hear. There's a difference. It could even be your own mom. It could even be your own dad. There is an anointing on that person, but you are only hearing this time. You are not what? Seeing. You are not seeing. You are not seeing. You are not seeing. Elisha received a mantle that belonged to the sons of the prophet. And Elijah told him, if you would see me go, it will be what? It will be yours. It means if you can't see it, it will not be yours. When you truly understand something, it jumps out like pictures. Have you spoken with somebody and then suddenly you say, "Ha, I see. It means that now it makes sense. I've processed it. It makes sense. God told Abraham, as far as your eyes can see, that will be yours. If you can see it, the Bible did not make a mistake. See and hear wisdom. They are not the same. They are not what? The same. Isaiah 2:1 says that the word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah, it goes on to say that the nation shall flow into it, and out of Zion in verse 3 shall go forth the law. Brethren, don't waste your youth. This is the time to sharpen your iron. The word of God is here. Say, out of Zion, out of the church. This is not the time to lift church. The action is here. The real action is in the kingdom. He said, out of Zion shall what? Come forth the law. The people of this world, they will come. The answers are here. This is the time to sharpen your what? Your iron. And Paul said the same thing, that I've been given the grace, Ephesians 3:9, to make all men see. King James Version or New King James Version. He said, but Solomon, the queen said that, blessed are your men. They are still blessed regardless, because they hear you speak every day. But as for me, I didn't come here to play. I came here to what? See. I believe the most valuable here is that she distinguished, or he separated what makes the difference between losers and gainers in life. Amen. So it is my prayer that the next time you take the word of God, you would see. It would jump out like pictures before you. Now, that was King Solomon. Let's switch gears real quick and talk about Paul and then reflect it and bounce it back to you. Amen. Because wisdom is the application of knowledge. We are wrapping up shortly. Remember the cars analogy I gave the last time, that now we've built smart cars, right? Where when it's darkness, you don't tell the car. It automatically reasons that there's darkness, and then it comes on what? Automatically. Remember that? Acts 28:8. I was looking for a scripture, and God has blessed me with one. Acts 28:8-10.
Acts 28:8-10. And it happened that the father of Publius lay sick of a fever and dysentery. Paul went in to him and prayed, and he laid his hand on him.
Paul went in to him, and did you see Paul asking any permission here? Are you with me? There was a problem. There was somebody sick. Paul went in and did what? Go on.
And he laid his hands on him and healed him.
Go on.
So when this was done, the rest of those on the island who had diseases also came.
All problems came, and he
healed
by the grace of God. Go on.
They also honored us in many ways. And when he departed, they provided such things as were necessary.
May people honor you in many ways. You don't understand the scripture. It's so sweet. It said they honored him in many ways. They honored him in many ways. If I were you, I would claim it for myself. I receive honor in many ways. Honor is coming to me in many ways. Prophesy upon yourself. Honor is coming to me in many ways. Amen. Let's take a 2 seconds pause. I want that to sink in. Could it be that your inability to put your faith into action is what is blocking your own testimony and your own miracle? Paul did not need any permission here. His light came on automatically. He didn't go and beg. He saw a problem and fixed it. And the Bible said that he was honored in many ways. You have been praying, sir, waiting on God, sir, taking communion, sir. Today is the last time. As you leave here, go and do something. Just start. Just start something. If you don't start, you won't finish. You see a problem within the jurisdiction of your grace or your anointing, go ahead and solve it. The Bible says we've all been given a dimension of faith. You should be able to vet your geography or the geography of your anointing in the spirit. If you call me to do worship, you know me, I cannot lead worship. You should be able to tell by the things, the results around you, certain, at least to a certain what level. And if it's there, it's there. If it's not there, it's not there. Say, brother, press on. Sister, press on. But make up your mind. As you live here today, say execution. Execution. Slow motion is better than no motion. I've preached here before. I said no motion, no impact. No motion, no. No motion, no. A parked car does not turn. Amen. Amen. General wisdom. General wisdom. Let's break it down so even that a toddler can understand. Everyday examples. There has to be foolishness for wisdom to find value. Does that make sense? You see wisdom all around you, but sometimes it's become common, so you don't realize it. When you go to the parking lot and you see those white lines, it's wisdom. Take wisdom out, and you will see how chaotic this world would be. When you go to the airport, you see those terminals, you know, departures and arrivals and the plane numbers and the numbers. You see the order, you see the excellence, you see wisdom, but it's become too common, so you don't think that is wisdom. Whoever built that has to be paid and rewarded well. Because if you take that out, you will see confusion. When you get to the traffic light, you see wisdom, but you don't think that's wisdom. What am I doing? I'm trying to touch on some few things, everyday examples, to see that there is something you can also fix. We have been all called to do one thing or the what? Or the other. Jesus did not build any place of worship. He understood that. And I see a lot of new people who have come, you know, to study abroad. But I want to submit to you, and just all of us overall, the biggest asset you can build is not mansions and cars. They are all good. There is a place for that. But the biggest asset you can ever build is people. Amen. It's what? People. A life well lived is a life that is buried in the hearts of men. You don't just die. You get buried in the hearts of men. This is general wisdom. Kingdom men take assignment from God. Miles Monroe said this one day. It was one of those breathless moments for me. It hit me. He said, no, kingdom men don't do 9 to 5. They take assignments from God. 9 to 5 is a season. Please track with me. Ideally, in this kingdom, 9 to 5 is a season. It shouldn't be a lifetime. He said, kingdom men, they take assignments from God. When it's done, Lord, what's the next assignment? Lord, what's the next assignment? God gave us work. He didn't give us jobs. Work is what you have been made and called to do. Job, J-O-B, just over broke. Men give jobs to help them build their dreams. Men give jobs. God gives work. Everybody here, there is a work. There is a true calling on your life. And your prosperity is connected to that. In 9 to 5, again, I'm not despised. It's great. You learn something. You learn the skill set. You learn experiences. But after a while, ideally, I don't want to talk down. There's a place for that. Ideally, before you retire, before you get to 65 or 70, ideally, if you can start something on your own, that would be great. The end goal is interdependence so that we can work together. You hold my hand, I hold my hand. I should have something. I should have my own platform. When I say platform, I'm not talking about building a church, please. You understand the context I mean. Amen. Ideally. And if you want to be wise, work with what? Wise people. Because wisdom, although God gives wisdom, it can also be learned. And you can reproduce the same results. My elder brother says it this way, follow who know road. In this life, follow who know. And I'm going to end with this. The wisdom of God. All that I say is generally, there is the wisdom of God. All the wisdom of God is hidden in Christ. And this Christ Jesus lives inside of you, which means there is a far superior intelligence in you, which is far greater than that of Parsolo, far greater than that of Cain. So because Jesus himself said that a greater than Solomon is here. And he lives inside of you. What is the wisdom of God? The Bible said that if Satan knew that killing Jesus would save the world, he wouldn't have done that. He saw the crucifixion. He only saw the face value. But God had another intelligence. That's the wisdom of what? Of God. What's the wisdom of God? See, the Red Sea, when the Israelites walked through the Red Sea, and I'm ending here, The Bible says that they walked on dry grounds. They walked on dry grounds. Ideally, if you go under the sea, even if you part it, the ground should be muddy. It should not be dry. It should not be what? Dry. It should not be dry. That should not be the case. But here comes the wisdom of God. Because when you walk in the mud, there will be tracks. There will be traces. There will be reports of your past. But when you walk on dry grounds, which is the blood of Jesus, there is no trace of any records of your past. The word of God says that blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven. The word of God said, as far as the east is from the west, that is how far the Lord has plotted your what? Your transgression. The word of God says that now there is no more condemnation for those who are what? In Christ and walk after what? The Spirit. Today is communion what? Sunday. What can wash our sins away? There's nothing but the blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, precious is the flow that makes us white as snow. There is no other fount that I know, but nothing but what? The blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So if you are here and the enemy keeps bringing in accusations, know that you are the redeemed of the Lord. You are sanctified. There is no more blemish in you in the name of Jesus. And even as we take it, even as we take this morning communion Sunday, as Jesus hung on the cross, we know that the Red Sea was a type of what? Baptism. As Jesus hung on the cross and they pierced his side with what? We know this story. We know it very well. Pierced his side with what? With a spear. The water came out and the church was birthed. And we began to what? To march on. So the church is marching on. And as we were marching, we also walked through the dry grounds with Jesus. And as he died, we died with him. And as he resurrected, we were raised up in Christ. This morning, I release the power of resurrection into your spirit, man. From today, nothing dies in your hand. Nothing dies around you because of the power of God. In the name of Jesus Christ. How do you get wisdom? The Bible says, ask. And it surprises me. That's the only thing, well, not the only thing. It says that, well, our brother James did a good job on this. He said that he gives liberally without finding fault. That is not say, oh, you sinned yesterday, I will not give you wisdom. Oh, you were drunk yesterday. Oh, you went to the club yesterday. He said he gives without what? Finding fault. The word of God says that ask and you shall what? Knock and it shall be what? The fact that we are not getting that, it means we are not seeking hard enough. The book of Proverbs describes wisdom as a fire. And some of you single guys, small thing now, then you give up. You see your taste, small thing, then you give up. Knock and it shall be what? Knock and it shall be what? Some weddings are on the way, they are smiling. Knock and it shall be what? Father, we pray for wisdom this communion Sunday. May we see your wisdom come alive even in our generation. Give you all the glory. Amen.